Tetcher, you found a FeelsBadMan versus Ma.
Isn't it more?
More.
I'm pretty sure. Is it not or?
I mean, it depends which language there's.
God's sake.
I mean, this is MAA with umlaut on the A's. I mean, this could be Finnish, German. If you don't tell me where they're from, I wouldn't know.
I can tell you where they're from. Yes, Swedish, and I've also used the wrong A, I have realized.
Mars Swedish?
Yeah, it's an A with a single circle above it, not a double circle.
Yeah.
Which I still think is O. Hang on.
Oh, I'll just write it without special signs on it. I think that'll be easiest.
The Gluehammer team is FeelsBadMan.
With an exclamation mark, if I'm not mistaken.
You are not mistaken.
What a great team name, isn't it?
It is a great team name.
Do you think in Europe we've got the best team names here?
Oh, absolutely.
Okay, very good. Let's jump right into it.
Thank you, Swedish people. Telling me I'm doing things right for once. That's new for me.
FeelsBadMan against Ma. First map is going to be Towers of Doom. First time we see it today on this broadcast, so that's really excellent. Different battleground mechanics than most. On this one, you cannot directly assail the core. There's a deadly line where you will take artillery damage. If you try to somehow smartly fly past it, you'll get ejected with all possible speed. And yeah, there's just no way to the core. The only way that you can damage it is by shooting cannonballs through a myriad of different options. I won't tell you all of them. I'm going to leave some as a surprise, but
we will explain that as it goes.
Yeah.
It's going to be good. Tiger's being hovered over as the first ban for the right-hand team, Moore. And there it is. First ban.
Okay.
See what it is.
I wouldn't call it really a Towers of Doom ban. It's just...
No, it's a standard ban.
Yeah.
Tiger's is scary, so ban Tiger's.
Now, there is the option here to go for Vikings or the Haka first. Both are very powerful picks on this battleground. And Ma needs to figure out which one they think is most threatening to be going up against. That is their ban. That makes Tychus kind of a junk ban, which puts Ma in a dilemma of them maybe not really knowing who they're having to deal with.
Yeah, it could possibly be called a throwaway ban, but it's not, because it's a decent ban. It's just, like you said, it's not a map-based ban.
Right, Artanis, yeah, okay.
Being banned out here by FeelsBadMan.
Artanis and Stitches are a little bit better on Towers of Doom than on others, because your outer fort is your only fort, and your fort is next to the opponent's fort. Normally, once forts die, the distance from a keep to another keep is extremely large. But here, people are always defending from their own, you know, their own perimeter. And Artanis can pretty much reach that with a Q into a swap. And then put you in his own tower line.
Yeah, there's also the wonderful thing of the just flipping into your own actual cannon area. I still noticed the death line. I think you called it very early, very well earlier. You can get a really good spot.
Tetcher, let me stop you for one sec. Didn't Tychus get banned first?
Mm-hmm.
And then how is it Mal first pick on the right side?
Oh, then you've got the bug. I guess I'm swapping you to right hand. Okay, so now we know. Swapping to right hand team
is also not a good thing.
Yes, let us prevent that from happening.
Okay, so what is happening right now?
Right now, the picks are fine. It's only the bans that are swapped every time.
So the Tychus is banned by the right side team?
Tychus is banned by red team, yes. You can tell whichever way the arrow underneath the timer is pointing, that is always correct. The icons at the top are sometimes not.
I've never seen that arrow before. Are you kidding me? What?
The more you know.
Wow, there's like
speed
lines.
So yeah, you can see the arrow is currently pointing to the left, it's showing the right as banning. So
okay.
You
know,
look at that way.
Okay, well, we learned that you must also not be moved to the other side as the observer.
We're learning. We are learning, and that's always good. You should not be playing Heroes of the Storm with the intent of getting better without learning.
So inspiring, Tetra. Will you be my teacher?
Sounded better in my head. Rhaegar getting Mavado as the bad here for more. In fact, they do remove that, which is makes sense as one of the heroes that could combo with Diablo, but not Thrall, I think, may have been a bit of a better ban.
I'm not going to talk about the bans. I'm too confused about the swaps. The fact of the matter is those four heroes will not be played. That's enough information for me.
I'm used to it. I've been, like, almost all the games so far, I've had it the wrong side.
Okay.
Because I've been trying to get you in.
Well done. Yeah, I haven't noticed, so well done.
Good.
Okay, so FeelsBadMan, they've got double warriors. Unless they want to go triple, it's time for some supports or damage. Now, what's still available? Let's see. Vala, Tracer, Thrall.
Boss-wise, Brightwing, still available. Karazim. Plenty of options. Morales, if they want to do some flying.
Yeah, I don't like Morales against Falstad.
I like Morales against most things, but it could be fun. Dropping Diablo on your opponents is always going to be satisfying. There's the Vala. Like you called that, very scary early, and they could pick up Tass with it and then pick up a second support. There's the Brightwing though.
So with Brightwing you leave Tassadar as your final pick, possibly, though I want to say you'll be a little bit light on damage, though not too much, I suppose, since you do have Vala. She can be your primary damage dealer and have everyone else just contribute. It's okay, it works. But you can still choose to just go solo support Brightwing as well, if you think the situation merits it.
This is true. It's very true. Like, I wouldn't feel too bad about solo damage Vala, especially with how squishy the team of Moor is. But there's also the chance that if you did go for that Tassadar, Archon still exists, and it can be used in certain situations. Yes, it can.
Archon does not exist, Tetra. Stop telling fairy tales.
It can be used. It has been used.
Do you know what I see when I see when you say Tassadar? You know what I see? 60% damage nerf.
Oh,
I mean,
God.
He went from 100 to 60%.
That was crazy. Well, we see Leoric and Johanna, the double two very good drain targets. I do like that. The hacker can burrow, but yeah. Diablo, incredibly good drain target. And Johanna, just a good amount of disruption and some blinds for Vala, which kind of limits them from going with the solo Vala damage dealer. They sort of need some ability damage.
If Tassadar comes out, though, I think that might be best. I think that's... With the amount of damage that Towers of Doom has, with the amount of damage that Li Ming and Falstad represent, going solo Brightwing seems very fragile. It's also difficult to heal.
You could play around it just more global, like especially if you went for the bribe that Brightwing has. Pixie Bribe? I can't remember what it's called, actually.
Yeah, Pixie Charm.
That's the one. Yeah, they could run with that and just try and play around the map a bit more, which could potentially work. And the sheer amount of CC they have could work out, or even Emerald Wind for extra healing. There's a couple options. And it is... Okay, so extra damage, all good, with Brightwing as the solo heal.
Okay, solo heal. It's not going to be Emerald Wind. You don't need that against a team like this, so at least they will have probably Blink Heal. Would they go with the Hypershift build, or probably the Soothing Mist, the Unfurling Spray?
Soothing Mist build combined with, obviously, Shield Dust to protect against Li Ming.
Yeah, Shield Dust, trait build with Blink Heal, I expect.
Yeah, I'm going to call Bribe as opposed to the extra radius, though, because they should not need that, I don't think.
We'll see.
All right.
Lunara, what do we think about Lunara?
I like it. It's good damage, good sustainable damage. Just, you can still take Giant Killer, so it can work quite well against Leoric.
Yeah, okay. You can Leaping Strike out of an Entomb.
Exactly. But quite a few options with that. I think I prefer it to something like Kael'thas, which would have just been blown up so quickly.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah, the potential of Giant Killer, Leaping Strike to dodge Entomb, and some extra burst damage. I don't think you go Thornwood Vine against Malfurion.
I agree with Leaping Strike for that one. Single target damage, the slow it offers is actually really nice.
I want to give a quick thanks to Toster423, Daners, TBaggins12, and Tazi50 for subbing. Also, Baykun.
Baykun.
Thank you guys for the subs. Baykun. Not bacon. Almost. Almost bacon.
Almost bacon.
Okay.
That's my name for pigs.
We've got the game underway. Towers of Doom. It's Feels Badman versus Ma. Actually, let me add that exclamation mark. Important.
Very important.
They don't just feel a little bit bad, they feel very bad. They're shouting it off the rooftops. Surgeon on Lunara, Krollo on Brightwing, Gloohammer on Dehaka, Sihu on Diablo, and Pshibli on Vala.
Whereas on the right-hand side, it is the red team of Moor. And playing for them, we have Suriz playing the Limeng, Hennig playing the Malfurion, Knutti playing the Falstad, Siku on the Lyric, not to be confused with Sihu, and Rask playing the Johanna.
That rascal.
That rascal. I do like that we have Ziku and Sik and Shiko. It's going to be lovely and confusing. Oh, Lyoric, that's rubby. He might escape, though. Is able to get out of there. Nicely done.
Use the Wraithwalk to get away. Not enough damage. And you're quite right. Pixie Charm is going to be coming out.
Yep, gets a lot of value on this map. Obviously, the Mercenaries, the Sappers, can do damage to the core. One of the three ways that you can damage
There's
the core in this
three.
Game. There's more than three. Oh, three. Oh, yes, there is. Isn't there? One of the four ways.
Capturing all the forts. Yes. Oh, nice Polymorph there. The power, of course, the devastating charge from Diablo cancelled the barrel roll. The Polymorph provides the slow, allowing Diablo to close the distance, do the overpower. Again, finishing him off. There is a price, though. They will lose two lane minions. And take a bit of damage here in the middle.
Dickle dashing in through the lane with that devastating charge to make sure he didn't miss any more. He has taken, in case you didn't notice, the Devil's Dew, the extra healing from his fountains and globes. This, if he can get 100 souls here, basically means a single region globe will heal him for about 36% of his health, which is very nice.
That sounds very strong.
It is very strong. But it does mean you don't get the extra duration on the resistance. So it's regen, but you have to find a globe. Or it is the extra resistant duration.
Yeah, from 2 to 4 seconds resistance after your charge is pretty good. But now healing fountains and globes will represent more healing. So both are pretty strong.
The fact he picked this talent makes me think that he probably may be going for a charge. Just that percentage damage to try and burst down Lyoric or Johanna. So we will see on that. Oh, right now, the two global heroes available for FeelsBadMan immediately going to start on their top objective. And Brightwing already teleporting into mid lane. She does have peekaboo to find everyone. No hiding in the bushes for Rask. Oh, nice charge by Diablo straight away. And wow, deleted.
Yeah. Yep, that's a longer duration stun there. Deceptively far, Diablo can go with that. And they get the double kill. Liming and Johanna go down. Lyoric will be able to get away. And that's going to represent the second cannon shots here for FeelsBadMan, who take a lead here. There they go. Boom, boom, boom. Protected. Excuse me? It's funny, it always says protected.
In the meantime, Krollo already managed to get one stack of his Pixie Charm. He will be able to get more as time goes on and be able to sneak those objectives. And it helps that his team is playing fairly grouped together. He's just getting so many stacks so quickly with this. But like you said, there was it from the shadows. Almost definitely going for a percentage charge build at this point, I would guess.
Yeah, Fire Devil did get nerfed, so it has a much more slow release effect in teamfights.
Uh-oh. Ruh-roh.
Oh, wow.
Camp
Raid. Thank you for the
camp. Gonna steal that away. Yeah, nicely done. Krollo having to escape here. He does survive, able to back up and play it nice and safe. Bit of harass from Shibli, which I'm positive I'm pronouncing wrong.
Shibli.
All good.
Shibli.
Bibli?
Shibli.
I thought it was Shibli.
It's a hard name. I don't think I'm saying it correctly either. This is Krollo, not Krollo, right?
Yes, I believe so. It might have been a name change.
There is a Krollo.
No, he's Krollo. He's Krollo on the bracket page.
Oh, so Krollo is Krollo.
Yes, just for a name change.
Yeah.
All good. So Shiku, pulling back a little bit here. His tower is out of ammo, but he does still have that bell tower, so he's going to be able to protect that with reasonable efficiency, and he now has Soul Shield. One of the best talents in the game, so now he gets even more regen from globes as the more souls he has, and he also is more resistant to spell damage the more souls he has. Currently, he has 81 souls.
81 souls, so he's at around 20% spell armor right now. Very, very strong against Liming and Falstad, who No, false thought, he is about 50-50 auto attack and spell damage.
He has boomerang, but yeah, he took the auto attack build, so it does work out here. And Li Ming did go seeker, so very much single target damage here, which can work to harass people onto that objective. Meantime, an engagement onto Leoric. He's fine, just able to sustain through that, but he was engaged up pretty hard and was forced to back up to his team.
Okay, we've got double towers here. It's going to be a bit hard for either team to really force a capture on it. Krolo is going for it, but there we go with the blind from Johanna. Wow,
oh,
massive damage
God.
By Suris. Brightwing drops to 30% life. A little bit more, and Brightwing will be going down. She doesn't have any burst healing for herself. That might just do it.
Blue Hammer, though, sneaking to the bot lane. As long as his team can hold this mid lane, they can grab at least one. Leoric going to try and interrupt him. Too slow. Blue Hammer gets that. Now he can come to help his team. Jekyll going super deep onto Nuti. But he's going to be punished for that. Down he goes. Still at only 81 souls. No revive for you.
Yeah, luckily for him, actually. You don't want to lose souls that early just to get revived. It would be after the party. This one has been secured by Team Ma here. And FeelsBadMan is okay to give that one up as they snuck this one. Good job by Dahaka.
Yep, who has already made his way up the top lane to begin pushing that in. Brightwing currently has 65 minions done, allies healed, sorry, on her Pixie Charms. So she already has two minions, two mercenaries worth of bribe there.
Three. It's 20 each. So
oh, it is 20
each. She can do a whole sapper camp at this point.
Yep, which is exactly what you want. You can just she can keep saving up, or she can wait for the next one to spawn. You probably want to use it on your enemies if you can get it safely, or if you're just about to rotate and need to take something very quickly.
Oh, Lunara runs into a trap, but will
nice
not
cleanse.
Be... Yeah, very nice cleanse, removing the condemn effect. Suris will not be able to hit those shots on an easy target there.
Yeah,
that was early. Scary. Did they spring the trap too early? Did they show themselves too early?
I don't think they did. I think it was just Ludara is a little bit faster than a regular hero, so she just had more time to get to her teammates.
Yeah.
Blue Hammer and Nuti having a little bit of a Barney up at the top lane, forcing Blue Hammer back. But Nuti, no spring chicken himself, already taking a lot of damage.
No spring chicken himself.
You know that one?
It's like having a lot of energy, right?
Yeah, pretty much. I'm pretty sure Krolo has eaten every orb. This entire game. Finally missing one. Nuti coming in for the harassment. The condemn pushes the wall in. There's the gust and the strafe to do the extra damage. The apocalypse doesn't do a huge amount, does get Rask, but this is a fairly dominating fight here. Coming in for FeelsBadMan. They're going to be able to take the objective and get all the kills. Finally, Valor getting the Falstad over the wall.
I could have done better.
Could have done better.
Could have done better. They only got the camp and all five heroes.
Yeah. They could have taken boss at the same time somehow.
Yeah, exactly.
Worst play.
Disappointing. FeelsBadMan. I just don't want them to get too, you know, optimistic and rename themselves.
Yeah, that would be devastating. We know that everything is ruined.
Very nicely optimized to actually take down the fort, or I should say bell tower, before capturing, giving one bonus cannon shot, leaving the core now at 23 HP.
Yeah, and in the meantime, Brightwing made it so there's multiple things to defend by taking the saps up in the top lane. One did die before it got used, second one killed the tower, and it looks like we will see more able to kill off the third one before it got a huge amount of use. But it did create some rotations, some rotation need for more there, which means it's only Leoric currently killing this bell tower, which means it's going to be there for even longer and give even more time for FeelsBadMan to get map control.
He's actually going to get slowed soon by the tower.
He's out of minions, yeah. Enemy minions have in fact arrived, they're going to do some damage.
Oh, the preemptive gust is going to barrel roll over the wall. No, he's not! Cleanse!
Nice cleanse!
That's a good cleanse.
Very good cleanse. Nicely done. Unfortunately, that is still five heroes versus two, which is less than ideal. They've finally taken down that bot bell tower. Sappers will be cleared up before they get to core. Nicely done. But this bell tower is going to go. And now we've reached why this map is so difficult. The rotation game. If you get behind on the rotations, you can be in trouble. But there's the blessed shield. They want to try and make something out of this, but no, not enough.
Pointless blessed shield. The tower is already down. There's no damage follow-up.
Yeah, there were three versus five.
Yeah.
Wasn't worth.
No. Captain America shield coming out there for no reason. 40 second cooldown. He's actually using... Wow, he's using Iron Skin just
I think he was face checking and thought they might be doing boss and didn't want to get stun locked.
Yeah, makes sense.
It's risky, but it's risky because he doesn't have it for a while. But if he's only going to be clearing this, he has the time to use it.
Sappers at the bottom. Let's see. Sappers, if they do 30-40% damage on the tower, that's bell tower down again. They've got 15 seconds. Yeah, they're definitely going to go for it.
That doesn't mean they might be a little bit slow on the rotation up to the top area. Brightwing needs to move from where she is. There we go, getting back behind the wall. Bell tower, game taken down. All the sappers used though, none will push through and keep the Auric busy. The Auric though, nowhere near the objective. And Brightwing attempting to delay, but not much he could do. This, on the other hand, Diablo can do something.
Oh wow, they captured...
Denied by a Diablo. Diablo's done. Oh, bye, Falstad! That charge into Aimbok takes him out so quickly. Heading also being forced back thanks to taking a leaping strike from Surgeon, which did just huge damage there. Nice burrow to dodge that disintegrate.
God, they very nearly had it, but that Hellstorm from Diablo.
Yeah, worked out in their favor. Ziku has finally arrived. Try and do some harassment. Shots coming in. Brightwing finally grabbed the shots on their own side, and there's the shots from this side of the map as well. Another six shots going over. Sorry, five shots.
Yeah, with that bell tower being capped, that's 10 shots there for FeelsBadMan. Siku finally goes down. That's 100 souls reset back to zero. But what an achievement here.
Yeah, they're so far ahead at this point. 32 to 13 right now. Looking great for them. Also, talent-wise, I was correct in calling the Devastating Charge talent that extra percentage damage, and he's already got a fairly decent amount of stacks. He's already got two stacks from it, so 4% extra damage on any target he hits, and is immediately starting on minions.
Oh, wow. Leoric goes down. I didn't realize it was 5% when you knocked him into wall, up to a maximum of 15. Every time you do it, it goes up by 2. Cool.
Yeah, it's a powerful ability. You can get some good percentage damage on Twitch. There's the gust! Look at them pulling back in! Johanna! They're moving back in, but there's a huge amount of damage. Oh, they will good. Actually steal it, but the synergy is good.
He's like, get over here! He's like, no, I was pushing him away.
Oh, the synergy was good. But they did steal it. Mission accomplished. They got a kill. A Diablo, no souls this time. He will not revive. Sapper's pushed into the bell tower at the bottom lane. Minions will be cleared up and the build tower will survive though.
Well, that works out for Ma, as they got a kill off of it, they got the boss, they got equal XP, and on this map, no matter how far you're behind in core HP, as long as you can grab a hold of bell towers and XP, there is no comeback impossible.
Yeah, they're ahead in XP now, considering that they are down by 15 core health
and 7 takedowns. That's pretty impressive.
Yeah. This map is wonderful.
Yeah.
Seeing Shihu pushing in here, he currently has 7 souls, which is less than ideal. Nice interruption there onto Krodu. He's going to attempt to grab it. Oh, just short of the disintegrate, and he finally grabs it. But the Bless Shield will take down Valor, so they're able to get the kill at least. They may get Diablo as well. Brighton with the Blink Heal is going to try and keep him alive, and Shiku will escape there, as will Krolu. But Dahaka died in the bot lane as well to Knuti.
Yeah, that was actually pretty sick. I was watching that. Knuti was 100% life against Dahaka 40. He turns on Isolation, and at that point, I thought Knuti wouldn't have a chance anymore. He must have not done too much damage on Dahaka, killed him afterwards. So it was pretty close, but that is double cap. Is it a triple cap?
Yeah, they got all of them. They were able to push it. That's what that fight was, able to kill off Valor there.
Triple
it was a double cap. Krolu grabbed it because Disintegrate literally was an inch from him, from actually interrupting him.
But it's still a double cap for 10 points, and they only lose 3 themselves because they have the 5 bell towers.
Yeah,
the 4 bell towers.
They are sneaking it back. They're about to get bot bell tower. Never mind, they're about to lose Falstad because he got globaled.
The Haka with the backstab, I suppose.
Dahaka and Brightwing at the same time.
Ah, wow.
Meeting up with Surgeon, they were able to kill him off quite quickly. They did lose top bell tower though, so we are still seeing a little bit of snowball coming out here from Moore, which is going to make it a little bit difficult for FeelsBadMan, but they are no means out of this. They're still ahead currently in terms of core health. All we need to do is to get top back or start taking bot again, which is already on less than half health.
Sappers, let's see. Sappers will kill this fort.
Yeah, as long as these sappers don't get killed off early, but that would require them to come very far out, which is unlikely. There, the A-Bot, hot to Malph, good stun. The Blessed Shield to prevent the counter, the follow-up, though.
Oh, Malph will kill Diablo before he goes down with the Twilight Dream. The drag follow-up was very good by Gloohammer. He will actually dodge the Drain up there with the Burrow. Isolation getting some good value. Oh, the gust!
Hey, Sad just in
fire,
time.
Bye!
But Surgeon doing some good damage here, but the slow from Rask. The poison's good, but he barrel rolls there to shield himself and prevent the poison from being lethal. And they kill off the mercenaries before they go through to core.
My god, that was a cool fight. That was awesome. Everyone
cool
at 10% life.
There.
What's that?
There were so many cool little moves there.
Yeah.
Everyone did something fun. Right now, only one objective here. Rask gonna be grabbing that Brightwing or Tahaka deciding not to contest it. Only four shots because of that bot being taken. But they do still have control at the top, so works out even.
Yeah, 12 versus 8 takedowns now, whole of a lot better than about 5 minutes ago. And Ma is kind of crawling back in here. 19 versus 18, they're still 4 cannon shots behind. But the boss is coming back up in about a minute or so. And I don't know if we can have level 20 in time for FeelsBadMan. I guess yes, because they're going to get this bell tower.
Yeah, they can maybe get 2 if they're quick enough. They can rotate down to bot. Before clearing that up as quick as he possibly can. He has a fearful presence as well here, so a little bit of extra charge fun.
It's a very small radius.
Yeah, he didn't take impo- I'm kind of confused why he took that as opposed to overpower, where he could have get the extra reset on his Q to do more percentage damage. Oh no! That's bad timing for Dahaka.
Killed as isolation was activated at the very last half a second or so before it would have frogged and bring him up to almost full life again. Very nice surgical execution there by Ma. They take down Dahaka and they get the bell tower. And they'll rotate up. Can Brightwing actually get away from this?
Run. Nope. Teleport. Tried to teleport out, gets killed off. Was doing a good job soaking XP, but moved too far away from his base there.
He was so doing a bad job soaking XP.
He did a good job until he died.
Yeah, I mean, that's pretty much the most important part, isn't it?
I guess it is. So for now, we will see them just clearing up the bell towers. They're in the chase race. They can afford to give up this because it's one, but the problem is the boss is going as well. So they're going to be down to 1 or 2 core health here, basically.
Yep. Still that's 5 bell towers.
They have one fight left, basically. They need to kill this bell tower, bring themselves back up to even bell towers, and then, as 5, take one last fight at the next objective to try and put themselves back in the lead.
I wonder if they'll take an option on the cap every time, interrupting it at 99. No, he's just going to grab it. He doesn't want to take any risk.
A good choice, I think. Even with Brightwing dead, not worth it. But it's still the chase. It's still the worst scenario here. FeelsBadMan. They're still chasing all this.
Yeah. Brightwing is finally back again. They're starting to take top sappers to try and get back some control of this game. They'll be looking to push into top fort. Brightwing is back. We'll try to get some XP, I guess. I'm not sure how much XP still matters at this
clearing
stage.
Clearing the lane, I think, to start pushing into the bell tower so that when the team gets there, they can try and make a play while the hacker pushes this up. Brightwing does have 48 Pixie Charm stacks, so can move in to grab a mercenary camp once they have this bell tower back. But unfortunately, they've lost mid as well. And as such, the rotations will continue and top will die too.
Yeah. Well, they have to kill bottom fort before the top fort gets killed. Otherwise, we'll have one cannon shot here for Ma coming out. When you control all bell towers on the map, you'll have one cannon shot per 7 seconds or so flying to the opponent's core.
Yep, and that's pretty devastating. Right now, they're just going to grab bot and leave the rest. And I quite like this, actually. Yes, you can keep chasing forever, but you need to grab something to try and keep the enemy team busy to stop this rotation game. As long as they have one, they're not getting shot at. If they can win a fight, especially when the objective's up, then they can start bringing themselves back into this. Using the peekaboo there might be better for Shikul to stand a bit further forward here.
Exactly.
But this is what they're doing. They're looking for a fight right now.
Some big damage coming out on Gloohammer and Krollo there. Oh, nice Seeker hits on Gloohammer. He's got that Fireflies, reduced cooldown and mana consumption for and quicker travel speed as well for magic missiles.
Yep, Gloohammer positioning himself. They want to try and catch someone, but look at this. There's no reason for Boar to get caught out of position. They can just take the long route. Krollo dropping the bribe, though. That basically forces the fight, and that's actually really good for them. The Blessed Shield's good, though. Mighty Gust pushing Fibly so far away here. A-bop landing here. Nooty is so low, he's running away. He's able to keep himself. He's finally killed off there. But overall, it's a 1-0. But down goes Dahaka. Diablo completely rooted out of position as well. Now it's kind of down to Shibley and Sturgeon to try and do any kind of damage to the backline. Heading, taking a lot of damage. The Seeker does not hit. The ice block will, though. That is very nice. And baited. Down goes Fala and Sturgeon. Pull him back to his base. Nothing he could do but Brightwing. Sneaky deaky trying to get it too late. Denied. And that, ladies and gentlemen, is why you take Loon's Grace.
Yeah, it is. Yeah, he's going to try and interrupt that cap. For after all, any one cap here is going to be GG. Sturgeon, he's trying what he can. He did some great moves on Lunara, but in the end, it's not going to be enough. The altar has been captured, and Ma will make the comeback complete. Excellent job by them. Very entertaining game.
Very entertaining game indeed. Good job to Ma. Feels bad, man. It feels bad, man. But it's only game number one. They do have their opportunity to try and make a comeback in this series. And they were looking so good for so long in that game. So definitely still have a good opportunity here.
Yeah, they were like 1.5 levels ahead. They were 28 versus 13 in cannon shots, if I'm not mistaken.
They were, yeah. They were that far ahead. Wow. Well played.
Yeah, very, very good by Ma. Very evenly matched game between these two. Cool. Let's see where the next battleground is going to take place. Different drafts as well. Lunara not really seeing a lot of play these days. But if you just take a look at her value, showing the score screen once again, 57,000 hero damage, only one death, with Leaping Strike, Unfair Advantage, Wild Vigor, and Starwood Spear.
Only reason I would say she didn't get more kills is because she was doing a really good job of focusing onto Nooty, but Nooty was just on point with keeping himself alive over and over again via the barrel rolls to stop the poison from finishing him off.
He tried. He does have the most deaths on the team, so I guess he did not exactly have infinite barrel rolls. But...
He didn't. No, this is true. Didn't there used to be a level 1 talent that just reduced the cooldown to like basically a couple seconds?
He had a full barrel roll build. My favorite was level 7, free roll. Barrel
that
roll
was
doesn't
it, yeah.
cost mana. It was
value.
So bad. So bad.
I still like the extra range one. The extra range one on 4 is still not terrible.
Extra range and shield, 40% each.
It's pretty nice. Good to protect yourself against burst.
Very few Lightning people seem to take it.
To build up. I think it's very much against burst comps, which aren't as usual nowadays. Hmm.
Kaithal says, I'd really like to know how Falstad won the 1v1 versus the Haka bot. Yeah, it was a dilemma which one I was going to follow. There was action happening in two different places at the same time. I'm assuming the fact that he has hammer gains, the lifesteal at 4, really helped him. And he must have made sure not to damage the Haka too much during the effect of adaptation, because I remember it was more than 5 seconds.
Okay, join
that
now.
Fight took a question from Makaiti about Towers of Doom. Is it ever good to delay killing forts on Towers of Doom so you can kill all of them at once? In theory, it's good, Makaiti, but because generally you push with lane minions, it means that you have to leave the forts at 20% life, not zero, not like 1%. Because otherwise the lane minions will finish it off, maybe. And that is not that... Okay, maybe not 20, maybe 10. And it's not always safe to finish with heroes. Like, you can't just walk up there with Vala, do a multi-shot, maybe you'll die. Only Asmodan can do it safely. So, it is good, and people have been talking about it ever since the map got released. But I've never seen it executed well yet. People generally just go and kill it, even knowing that it'll get killed right back. Maybe the world is not ready yet.
We will see. For now, though, we are jumping in. Are your bans the correct side, sir?
How do I know? Look, it's the on arrow. The right side right now.
Which way is the arrow pointing?
Oh, yes, the arrow. Yes, correct.
Hooray!
Oh,
mine is wrong.
That's the giveaway. Okay, the arrow.
That's
yeah.
the giveaway. There you go.
Excellent.
Whichever way that's pointing, that's the correct one.
Okay.
So your bans are on the correct side. So, first ban for Team Moor. See what they do.
Daedalus, thank you for subbing. Battlefield of Eternity, Ma's gonna ban. Vala, Sylvanas, Tyrael, top picks on this battleground.
Any solo laners, also good ones. Thrall, Tahaka, Alarak, which we have not seen at all.
Yeah, that's true. Alarak is a really good defender on this map.
It's going to be Sylvanas, though, because we know the incredible amount of value she can get, so banning her out makes a lot of sense.
Four to five Ragnaros bans, zero picks. Is he getting overbanned? No, he's good here.
Yeah, he's good hero. Good hero, good value, especially on a map like this. Drop Ragnaros to defend the Immortal. Just crazy value. And Artadis first pick.
Yes,
I like that.
Love this hero. I love what he brings.
He's fun now.
Amateur opponents flying
how long I was. Do you remember how long I was calling Artadis for at offline events?
How long?
And then the since Katowice.
Yeah, but it doesn't count. He got changed.
That was my call. That was my call because he kept getting buffs, and I was like, players, don't play Artadis, because eventually they'll keep buffing him until he's so insane that everyone can play him at once.
Yeah.
And that's exactly what happened.
I misplayed Samuro release. I said he was fun when he was released.
Yeah, you made it. I saw your video just like, what you need to do is to not tell anyone.
I should have been so stoic. I should be like, this hero is shit. I'm not going to play him. Just get through the first 2 weeks without loving him and then just love him forever. Now it's the opposite. I guess he's still global second best win rate hero in the game at the ladder play at least. But yeah, anyway. ETC Rager comes out here for FeelsBadMan. Immediate insta snap call, Malfurion.
Yeah, the combo of Artanis is super insane. It just gets some crazy value here. And now they need something to combo with the mana regen aspect of him. Valor would be crazy here because you can just get spamming out the abilities, but they choose Li Ming instead.
Like Li Ming here too. Very reliable way to finish off an immortal, which is being well defended. Missiles, arcane orbs.
Very true. Very true. See if it works out for them right now. Diablo ban coming in here for FeelsBadMan. The more what they want to ban out. What would be sensible here? Range damage, because they already have Li Ming, maybe banning out Valor themselves.
Yeah. Yeah, it could do Valor. Let's see. Tychus? I mean, Tychus is pretty good against Artanis.
It's true. Getting the drain potential would be good.
You remove the Bloodlust Odin possibility. Power slide into minigun damage, which is pretty bursty. I think you remove Tychus or Vala here, probably.
Now, hovering over to Randa, the extra vulnerable damage. Also quite good, and it's a follow-up stun for ETC.
She would be the creative ban. I agree with you. Taranda here would be pretty good, but I'm not sure.
All the knowledge is in the right place, but I agree with you, it's probably not the best one.
Yeah.
Looks like that's what they're going for, though. Committing to it. Taranda ban.
Good call, Chris.
Now, what do they pick? I would be very surprised to not see a Valor. Like we've mentioned, she's just crazy on this map at this point with Monster Hunter.
Yeah, Vala's possibility. Let's see. Vala, Tychus. You probably wouldn't go both. A mage? Do you go for a mage here?
For siege damage, potentially. Also follow up for ETC. Like, Kale Pass wouldn't be terrible here. You have a follow up stun for ETC with that.
Yeah. So, what about going Kael'thas and Vala? That would be pretty decent.
I like it.
Kael'thas, Tychus.
Both get value. Obviously, Kael'thas isn't going to get as much value out of Bloodlust, but you still get some good sieging to try and actually do exactly what Li Ming can do and poke down the Immortal when it's being defended, which Artanis can do effectively. The problem is, we've seen how well Artanis can do against a Kael'thas if you can get good flips. There's Valor, and there is the Tychus.
Aha, they do get both. Interesting.
It kind of makes sense, because Valor is going for not so much of an auto-attack build, because she's going for that Q build. So, it's okay.
I don't think you have to go full Q build. I think it's a bad case of Pictionary. you take the queue, it looks like Hungering Arrow, so you take the same picture at level 4, but I don't think you have to. It's like a pretty difficult quest stacking talent that you generally don't really complete too early. Get Monster Hunter at 1, yes, then play whatever else you would have normally played. It can be auto attack, it can be multi-shot. It's perfectly fine to go Q and then multi-shot.
I can see that, yeah, understood. You don't get the rewind on the Q there, but that it gives you a lot more potential in team fights.
I just see it as you go multi-shot Vala standard, but instead of the mana reduction of Hot Pursuit or the mana gain, you get the mana reduction on the Monster Hunter. And you get bonus damage on PvE instead of movement speed, which is fine. It's a small map. And anyway, Muradin Lunara comes out for Ma. How did they round this off? Tassadar would be very strong with their comp, but not that good to go Tassadar against Double Warrior.
Second, a melee or a bruiser. The role's been left open. Not the most high damage. They could Greymane, but that would be risky.
Oh, Greymane would be so risky. Gratuitous amounts of damage, though, but that would leave ETC like in a really tough spot. I think you need a second warrior or maybe Tassadar after all.
I think I like Tassadar purely because you want to try and give Rhaegar a chance to keep people alive against Lunara.
Yeah. Yeah, I like Tass too. Could go Zarya, maybe? Like, do you go Zarya here?
I think Zarya's good. Fills a similar role to Tass. Just quickly rewind to Tass again. Gonna throw it out there again. Tass of Archon, Bloodlust Archon. That's also melee. Wow. That's a thing.
Cool.
Very cool. I like it.
So it's
we're at land now, boys.
Yeah. First Zeratul of the tournament. Not just in picks, but also in bans. We haven't seen it. I actually kind of like it here against this team. Li Ming and Lunara can get picked on by him.
Yeah, we also have the potential of the wonderful VP mosh pit.
Oh, yeah.
Could be good. And at level 20, VP big red button.
Okay, sure. Yeah, I can see that.
I think I've seen it once in professional games, and it was very beautiful. But
VP
Reign
of Vengeance.
Yeah, but plenty of opportunities for that. But overall, both teams have really good drafts for this.
They
both have good immortal damage. Lunara, Nature's Culling, Artanis with amateur opponent.
Yeah. Yeah, I think, let's see, Tychus, Vala, the move, the attack speed aura from ETC together with Zeratul, I think they have the much better immortal damage than Ma here. Like, Lunara, some people say she's, like, great on the map and stuff. I mean, I don't think so. She has good poke damage. Li Ming and Lunara can kill an immortal that is heavily defended, easily. But they don't race the best.
Yeah, like, Artanis will help with that, but it's not going to be perfect. It requires you to fight a non-contested, non-defended immortal.
Yeah.
So yeah, it works on them. Oh, even more damage, the lightning bond from Rhaegar.
Oh, that's
gonna help him rush down even more.
Yeah, don't underestimate that. That's a lot of extra damage.
It's crazy. For now though, let us introduce the team. Starting on the left hand side in the top lane, we have Gluhammer playing that Zeratul. In the bottom lane, we have Shekul playing the ETC Krolu on that Rhaegar Shibli, on the Valor, and Surgeon playing the Tychus.
And in the red for Team Ma. We've got on the red side Knutti on Li Ming, Suris on Lunara, Rosk on Muradin, Hitting on Malfurion, and Artanis is being played by Siku.
Yeah, and we're going to be seeing immediate engagement onto Shekul here, who takes a lot of damage. Siku, not sure where that flip was aimed, but he does get out, he does survive here. And we do have a scouting drone for Malfurion. We saw it last time we saw Malfurion on this map. Good value, just because this area is just full of so many bushes, so many vents. So it makes a lot of sense. Gives you a huge amount of safer rotations.
Slightly hurts your trading on the Immortal, but I think it's worth it as well. Especially with like ETC. He is one of the best bush campers into gank killers.
So yeah, and ETC also, he did take the Guitar Hero, like you did predict. The extra attack speed going to give Valor huge value. And Valor, auto attack build, at least a standard build in fact, not going for Monster Hunter. Like you did predict.
Yeah, I think you're right though. I think he will go for auto attack build maybe, but we'll see. Yeah.
That's more a single target damage for the Immortal. Surgeon survives. There's the stun onto Henning, but no one there to follow it up, heading more back up, and they get some good damage onto Schickle here.
Nice shot by Knutti, getting double magic missiles there on Shibli.
Yeah.
By the way, of course, scouting drone also reveals cloaked heroes. Well, that's nice against Zeratul.
Indeed, and speaking of Zeratul, he's having a wonderful little duel up there of Shakurus versus Aya up here in the top lane, Gluhammer versus Zickle.
Looked cool, what Rusk did. 10 points for style.
Style points, some of the most important in Heroes of the Storm.
For some people, yeah.
Immortal coming down here. Scouting drone drops in a great position here, very hard to get to destroy. Most people seem to want to put it in the vent just above the Immortal, but it can actually be killed by the Immortal there, and it's easy for enemies to get into. Nice face melt by Jiu there. Very troll.
Yep, nice face melt.
So, half health reached very quickly by FeelsBadMan, putting themselves in a great position to continue racing here. We did call it. Scouting drone moved to the middle of the map, trying to prevent the rotations. Suriz, run away! There's the stud, and down he goes.
Yeah, well done. FeelsBadMan get the kill, and that should really secure them the Immortal entirely now. Artanas does what he can with the amateur opponent, but it's of course not going to be enough. It's 5 versus 4. They killed Lunara in that attempted defense. And there we go. Yeah. Immortal goes to FeelsBadMan.
Yeah, they're going to be moving that up to the top lane right now. It is Zikhu up here, which is going to be a little bit of trouble because he is melee. He has to wait for the Immortal to drop all its shields before he can actually get some amateur opponent value. And this is why it's sensible that he is currently rotating out. He's going to let Rask head up there to help defend, who at least has the ranged ability in the form of the Storm Bolt, as opposed to Shehu, who has to dash at it.
Shield search for Artanas. We do see that Creed of the Hunter auto textile from Vala. Pretty hard to stack. There aren't that many fights. He needs to hit many heroes with it 100 times, and then he'll get bonus damage. And he also has a passive bonus attack speed from the talent.
Yep, which is still very strong. Gives a fair amount of value, but for now, having to back up. Mortal gets taken down, and the fort does survive on half health. Jiggle getting some good soak for his team. Zeratul rotated up, thinking there would be a team fight, but instead, it was just a couple minions per effect, not too much, but one or two. Legion continuing for the moment in the top lane, trying to push that lane up, prevent any minions from getting onto the towers and lowering that ammo for FeelsBadMan. And also, with their slight level lead, they're attempting to soak and also look for someone to snipe with the good CC they get from Schickle.
Very passive role by Zeratul. He is a fine solo laner, mostly because he's mostly invisible. So he doesn't take a lot of poke damage. He's actually unnecessarily trading with Artanas here, which shows to me that he's just planning to Hearthstone out. Zeku could potentially mess with that. Missed the Murdering kill there. Must have been a nice power slide, minigun, entangle, face melt to cancel the Dwarf Toss action.
Yep, worked out well for them. Able to get another kill, or 2-0 currently in favor of FeelsBadMan, with Sergeant currently working down this mercenary camp, making it much harder for his team to kill it off quickly by using his grenade to separate them out, meaning that Rhaegar couldn't really use his lightning.
Smart mount up and leaving by Siku. He could have been greedy and go for the gate, but actually he didn't know for a fact that FeelsBadMan was doing the top in Baylor camp. After they killed ETC, they went missing. They could have rotated past this bush, go south, try to gank Artanas. So Siku played it safe. Played off of the information he had, which was a smidget less than what we as observers had.
So, having a look at some of the talents here, we are seeing Calamity from Li Ming instead of that Seeker for that single target damage. So going for a little bit of a resets, engage, and killing the enemy strategy. We do see Nature's Culling from Lunara, like we did predict, just the incredible amount of poke damage onto the Immortal that she can get with that. But Tychus, the Relentless Soldier, going to make it much harder to lock him down.
Gluhammer went for Wormhole, not the
sustained.
What was it called? The
Sustained Anomaly.
Is it Sustained Anomaly at 7?
I think so.
The one maybe, where you can teleport on your Singularity Spike.
Yeah, maybe. I'm not sure. Either way, used Wormhole to get a kill there. Got some great value out of that. But in the meantime, they did lose. They're about to, in fact, thanks to Lunara, lose half health on their Immortal. Wait for it.
Wait for it.
There it goes.
Wow, Lunara value.
Lunara value from across the map. But however, they are now down a they're down a hero. Artanis is still on the move. He has to run all the way from base here. And such that's going to give them a bit of a disadvantage on actually defending. The Ming, though, getting some value on that, getting some good poke potential out.
Yeah, if only he had the Triumvirate, he could have done another orb again. But he's got Dominance. He wants to capitalize on teamfights. Like you said, Dominance and Force Armor, full safety talents, and then Calamity to finish people off. Get those resets and heal up. It's aggressive defense, Li Ming style.
Yeah.
Good choice against
Seeker in the Dark, by the way.
Oh, yeah. Seeker in the Dark. Thank you.
No worries. Sustained Anomaly was the, I believe, the old one that we had.
The old level 4 where it would explode and hang in the air.
That's the one. Which is cool. Yeah. Very rarely used, but still a cool idea. Get some great synergy with it. So Artanis going down to the bot lane, soaking XP for his team, while the Immortal, with a pretty decent shield, over a third shield actually, going to be pushing in here to try and do some siege damage. Inara poking in. She doesn't have Thornwood Vine yet, so she can't get all of the poke potential she would want to otherwise, but still microing in her auto attack, stutter stepping, which is one of the best things you could do on Lunara. We already talked about the importance of stutter stepping on Lunara. Increase that by 10, and that's Lunara.
Yeah, on Vala last game, right?
Yeah, Vala as well, yeah.
Death Dealer, Creed of the Hunter. Cool. Level 10 Esmer Reach, yep. Thornwood Vine, Suppression Pulse, Avatar. Probably Wave of Force for Moshpit, but he's going to probably hold on to that because the Disintegrate can be nice to reveal his Aerotool and to do some long-distance finishing damage, but you need Wave of Force against Moshpit.
I believe we discussed this at one point a while ago at Valencia, I think. The one time you can get value from Archon Pure Power is basically if you're against if you're either all-inning a core or if you're against the Zeratul and you just activate it periodically and spin.
Yeah.
Just to try and reveal Zeratul.
Yeah. Of course, it makes you a target because the Archon makes you unable to teleport while you have it, and there's a small a transformation time. But it can be nice to reveal him if your team is sure to help you, yeah. It's Wave of Force versus Mushpit.
Yep, and another time we've actually glossed over a little bit. Follow through on Artanis here, going for the Immortal Burst damage as opposed to that slow on the flip to try and catch heroes out of position. Which makes sense, we have Vault, we have Dash, we have so many ways to escape.
Zeratul isn't here, and Ma knows it, so they're playing more aggressive than they otherwise would. They're also grouping up a lot. This kind of behavior will be more and more lethal once Void Prison comes out. And now that Zeratul has gone missing, look for them to maybe preemptively continue to spread their positioning. You never want to get caught in a kind of four-man Void Prison, because that will mean a four-man mosh pit.
Yep, pretty much, and that is the worst way to lose the game, or at least the worst way to feel, because you have to physically wait for that mosh pit to get set up, because they can take their time with it.
It's the Heroes of the Storm equivalent to StarCraft's Archon Toilet.
Yeah, it's just like, oh god, I know I'm going to die, but I have to wait for it. So you're wading forward here, doing some great damage with Artanis getting taken down after being called out of position, Cleanse keeping Skrull alive here, and Suris trying to get any kind of poke here.
Artanis there got killed a bit too far forward. Suppression Pulse came out too late. He was already dead. Overall, not too bad of a case, actually, for Ma, as they do a lot of immortal damage here. Almost even.
Oh, the one man VP, but it is on the best target. Can they get it? The rune prevents the power slide, and Zeratul barely taken out. And Zeratul, though, was annihilated as well, thanks to the Twilight Dream.
Yeah, he actually missed his W on Lunara. He mistimed his own W on his own Void Prison, so that made him have to blink in, and it got him killed by Twilight Dream. So many knock-on effects.
Yeah, but he took a heroic, actually, which probably wasn't required. Like, I think that was just preventing getting the kill, but instead he drew a heroic out and still got the kill. So yeah, not the worst scenario for Zeratul there. Right now, Grask attempting to delay Shikor and Krolu from going to the Immortal.
Very nice body blocking. Excellent job by Russ. Very good.
Yeah, and he's getting the attack speed slow, but he has that on base kit now. Just continuing. Ooh. There's the stuns. Can he save it? No, it's so close. Now can he get out alive? Probably. He has Dwarf Toss.
Oh, narrowly goes to FeelsBadMan. A lot of cool actions there, both attack and defense. Rask tried to do what he could to buy time for his team, but they got a bit distracted. They went to go and kill Tychus instead. It was almost too good to ignore. It was a guaranteed Tychus kill. Unfortunately, Malph died to Zeratul and Tychus' combined attacks.
Yeah.
You've got to wonder what would happen if they just ignore Tychus. They'll probably have to Immortal, though.
Yeah. The thing is, they can defend this Immortal fairly free and get a kill from it if they can get Krolu, which they can. Immortal dies and getting the kill. Resets for Li Ming. Beautifully done. Nothing to use the resets on, but that was nice. They had basically an uncontested defense, so they lost like a tower and a gate, which was already low, and they were able to get the kill. So that went beautifully. They got Tychus out of that and Rhaegar.
Did you see that? Artanas bugged out. He max distanced into this little thing here. So he didn't get the range he was looking for to do the swap.
Yeah, a little bit weird, but that's what you that's what you get when you have a ability that allows you to go through terrain.
Yeah. It's a predictable process of using the ability. It's his fault, but it was just funny how it looked. He kind of got like pushed back out.
Indeed.
Yeah, so good defense with the Rhaegar kill. They actually come out ahead in terms of XP. They're still ahead in terms of forts, so good job, Emma.
Yeah, triple strike for Artanis here. So he's 100% all in on killing this Immortal as quick as possible. So he's triple strike, even with the increased cooldown, it still gets you 3 hits of amateur opponents, so it works out quite nicely. Great Dispel Shield, trying to block some of that Zeratul damage on Lunara. Ice Block for the exact same reason.
Yeah.
Illusionist. Just trying to protect Li Ming and give her more value on that Calamity. And Mending Strikes for the Zeratul here.
Artanis, the combo breaker here. Everyone chose for safety. But,
yeah, except him who went all in on PvE.
Yeah. Crazy Artanises, man.
Indeed. So Zeku clearing that up quite quickly with the help of his team. Surya's also doing some crazy damage thanks to that Nature's Culling. Blue Hammer, very far forward. Dude, he tried to grab him there with that Illusionist Calamity. Instead, gets punched down. No, over the wall. Blue Hammer goes for the kill, though, and is able to grab that. Zeku in full retreat. Shield activates. Tries to get some cooldown reduction onto that shield. Dashes through into a mosh pit and gets taken out. The Void Prison grabs the other two. Timing.
Timing. Did you speak it?
Zuriz is on the run, trying to escape, but he's on his own. He won't be killed off unless Zerat Blue Hammer's found him. Miss. Got him. Can you kill him?
Yeah.
Oh, the spell shield actually did protect him there. He's run into a tower, though.
Random tower appears.
He's still going. Oh, that's not... He
killed the wall.
He killed a wall. Worth. Got it. Well, either way, it's a full team wipe. And the Immortal.
Honestly, I feel like it was kind of Siku's fault here. There was danger pings everywhere. They were he was forward positioning into territory unknown where you know there can be a trap. There was a danger ping that guarded him away from this path, then another danger ping that guarded him away here, and he went anyway. He got caught by Power Slide, and everything else that happened afterwards is because they got caught in a fight. But basically, they were not really ready to start that way. So, unfortunate, and this is a massive shield. Immortal here for FeelsBadMan, who, off the back of this, may be looking to go all the way to the keep.
They may try. The fort has full health. There is a half-health tower in front of it, but that Immortal is basically going to kill that in one hit, because it does a crazy amount of damage. Goodbye. And it's now going to push on. Zeratul wrapping around. VP will be up in 13 seconds. Rask was ready for him, though, thanks to that scouting drone.
Good glue hammer movement. He did not get dismounted. Of course, they know where he is, probably.
Yep, he's still revealed. He was still revealed by the scouting drone, so even there. So now the scouting drone finally killed off. Blue Hammer just rejoining his team. But, like we said, VP still available here.
Odin gets turned on. Bloodlust is still available. They probably turn it on right as the gate has been broken. Moshpit in two.
Yeah, it's available. Don't group up there, Mo, or you're going to find some serious trouble. Zeratul still unstealthed for the moment. Finally re-stealthing, about to be...
there's
the
mosh pit
though, but good cleanse. Mosh pit not able to grab anything, but huge damage from Li Ming trying to get some value, and they're actually able to grab two kills straight away. Artanis goes down 2-for-1.
Not a good mosh pit. The suppression pulse came out, which means of course the entire team is going to try and dodge it, as they're very reliant on auto attack damage to do anything, and he uses that time to go forward and power slide mosh pit. Unfortunate. Surgeon, he wants to go for the finisher. No, he doesn't.
Yeah. Gonna get the kill onto Krolu, though. killing that off quite quickly with the help of Rask, and that even gives a reset to Nuti for topping him up on the like 2 health he had missing. But either way, they're able to push in, and they're going to be able to do some damage to the Keep. Now, but Tiger's punishing Rask.
Wow.
Percentage damage.
Yep, pretty good. Even though all that happened, the suppression pulse into power slide, mosh pit attempt against 2 members way too deep, I still got to hand it to Ma, man. They handled it really well. That was not an easy fight. Very chaotic, indeed. Lots of damage coming their way, and they all stayed alive, got the kills, and defended their keep.
Yep, the keep surviving is definitely the biggest part of that, because they were able to go in and put some pressure onto bot keep, meaning that neither team has a safe bottom lane right now.
Nimble Wisp checking the bush here. They will try to go for a trap here. Camp Steel, they know, is overly ambitious. They hope to go for a trap, but they got spotted and they wisely disengage. They still have enough time to go do their own bruiser and not risk everything. They know if they lose more members here, they will lose their keep. Whereas they cannot promise the same thing because they're not as far along. So they play it safe, and I think that's the correct move. Good job, Emma.
Yeah, they're showing just incredible restraint here in this game, which is definitely a good thing for them. Now they're going to get some good value out of Lunara, able to siege this from range, get some value out of that Nature's Culling, which now has the right color, might I add. Thank you, Blizzard.
Yeah, exactly. Nice. Yeah, that was so... That was a sore sight.
That was tilting. There's the Sun cleansed out. He's able to back up. He's going to heal himself quite quickly with the help of Crowley, thanks to Guitar Hero.
Oh, look at
but
this.
But now we reach what we said the issue was, the siege potential that Nuti and Suris have.
Yeah, this is actually where Lunara and Li Ming shine. It's when the Immortal is in a really crappy position, getting damage on it nonetheless.
Zeratul.
Oh, triple man, Void Prism, Bloodlust comes out. Really good suppression pulse, though.
Oh, Mosh Pit
will... Oh my god, Mosh Pit gets cancelled immediately. Shibli gets taken out. Rengar gets taken out as well. It's a massacre.
My god, that was incredible. They're going after Surgeon as well. He's on the run. Have you ever seen a mech run away? Now you have.
How could a mech get poisoned, Tetcher?
I don't know, but they found
Checkmate,
a way.
Atheist.
I'm going to core get poisoned. They found a way. They're now moving into that top keep. Going to try and take that down and move in, even without the Immortal here, because it's going to take too long. Going to take that down with just a huge amount of percentage damage they have. They don't have Malfurion, but they don't need it. They have all of the heroes that will do bonus damage to those structures, and they're just going to go in for the end.
I'll tell you what, Tetcher, that suppression pulse ruined everything. You set up a Void Prison that's just... God-given, and you've got so much damage follow-up, and none of it amounts to anything because of one suppression pulse. Amazing.
Also, just the incredible timing on that flip. You heard donk, 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 flip. That's exactly the perfect timing he got there. I don't know if he actually got the full cooldown on it. I didn't check.
No. It was definitely a 10-second cooldown, but that's all it takes, isn't it, for the fight to completely go in the favor of Ma.
Nice.
Very nice.
Done. Yeah, so, wow. That 2-0 to Ma.
Yeah, I would say that's kind of an upset. If you look at the names on FeelsBadMan, Krolu, Sihu, Shibli, Surgeon, and Gluehammer, I wouldn't say that they lose to...
I recognize one name on Ma.
I do recognize everyone on Ma as well. I play ladder with these guys all the time. I know they're good. But I'm still impressed, both by their comeback in game number 1, as well as their comeback in this game as well. Really good.
Yeah, it was a comeback, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Wow. That was awesome. Glad we had that.
Other one as well. It's greedy anyway, going for that one. There can be no doubt. Oops. I envisioned it differently. Double kill!